I welcome you to this lecture under the Summer University program. It has happened that every year in the Summer University I have been asked to give lectures on the National Movement, partly because it's one of the most important events in Indian history in our past. Partly perhaps because it's important for competitive examinations. So for both these reasons, both quite adequate in themselves, this has been chosen as a subject in the Summer University program. This is the first time, and I hope the last, that we are having such a large number, because usually this was restricted to about 30 or 40. Anyway, I welcome you all, and I'd like to explain how I will proceed. I hope all of you have the synopsis of the first lecture. I will generally try to follow the synopsis. Now, the first point to begin with is the term national movement and what it symbolizes, what it indicates. The essential word is national. So what is the meaning of nation from which the word national comes? Those who are students of political science or history are familiar with this problem. Others may not be so familiar. So I will say a few words about it. Countries have existed in history for a long time. They are geographical regions. For instance, India, with its northern boundary, the Himalayas, and in the south, the peninsula surrounded by the sea, forms a geographical region. Now, in this geographical region, movements of people are much easier than across either the sea or across the mountains. So languages generally in this area are akin to each other. They may be different, but their roots go back, say for in the Indo-European languages, to the early Indo-Iranian family of languages, and similarly Dravidian languages of common origins. So people have affinities in language. They intermarry more than they intermarry with people of other countries. And therefore, the notion that India is a country is a not a very, very ancient one. It is not there in the Rig Veda. But by the 3rd century BC, Ashoka was speaking of the country of India. And later on, in 1st century BC, the word name Bharat, or in Prakrit Bharat, was given to this country. Other names also were given. Iranians gave us the word Hindu, from which Hindustan is an Iranian word, came into use in Iran first, from around 3rd century AD, and then it came to India. So whatever be the name, there was a concept of a geographical region. But nation is more than a country. Nation means that the country is also a political unit. It should be a political unit. That is the first difference between a country. A country may be a political unit or may not be a political unit. But it's only when it's political unit in conception that the word nation is applicable. Now, several historians, like the historian who students of history would know about Tarachand, believed that India as a nation arose in the Mughal times because the Mughal Empire gave a unity to the country. Now, this is only, of course, partly true. the empire and the country, as in the time of the Mauryas, coincided. But it was not necessarily the belief of everyone that India should be a united political unit and ruled by the same government. It was actually in the world, for the first time in the French Revolution of 1789 in Europe, that the concept of nation, modern Kant's concept of nation, first arose. Before that, in the English language, you know, if Europeans talked in Indians about Indians, they talked of Brahmins as a nation, Banyas as a nation, caste was often called a nation. So the word nation had various meanings. Any community could be called a nation. Just as the Persian and Urdu word qaum, it signifies, in the Mughal period, it signified a caste. In the 19th century, it signified a community. And today, qaumiyat means nationalism. So nation was a word of that nature. But it was in the French Revolution where the idea of national independence, each country is entitled to be a single political unit and an independent political unit. There are now two elements of a nation. Its people aspire to be a political unit, and its people aspire or want to be an independent unit. That is to say, in the language of John Stuart Mill, they want to govern by people from amongst themselves. Not necessarily a democracy, but among themselves. People from amongst themselves. Italians to be ruled by an Italian ruler, not a French ruler, and so on. The French Revolution added to the nation the idea of democracy. It was a tremendous change in human consciousness when the French Revolution of 1789 to 94 came about. The idea of democracy. Not only would there be a nation governed from amongst people belonging to that country, but it should be governed by and on behalf of the people of that country. So the notions of nation and democracy got intertwined in the French Revolution, got mixed up in the French Revolution. So French Revolution gave the slogan of national independence for all nations as well as democracy. Now, at that time, India had largely passed under British dominance. And for the first time, ideas from Europe began to exercise influence over India. Ram Mohan Roy, whom we will mention later also, was deeply influenced by the French Revolution. Born in 1772, died in 1833 in England. I'll speak more about him later. He was influenced by the ideas of the French Revolution. Indian social reform movements were influenced by the ideas of equality, particularly gender equality, equality between men and women and between all classes of people. What happened therefore after the French Revolution was the transmission of the idea of national independence from Europe to the colonies, first in Latin America, where I don't know if you have heard of Bolivar, B-O-L-I-V-A-R, the great liberator of Latin America, rebelling against Spain in 1820s. So the idea of nation was first transmitted to Latin America, and then it gradually came to India. As English education developed, people came to know about French Revolution, people came to know about these new values, especially those who were educated, and so the slogan came. Now, there has been a recent tendency, which I will just notice, particularly after a book by Benedict Anderson, whose name I think I mention in the synopsis, Imagined Communities, published in 1983. in which he argued that nation is after all an imagined community. It is not a real community like a family. Family is a biological unit, father and mothers and children, brothers of the same parents. This is a biological connection. The nation has no such connection. The nation, therefore, according to him, was artificial, superficial, created by the printing press rather than any actual real grievance against others. Now this is an important point. For what reason did India become a nation? Why did you have an imagined community? Let us say nation is an imagined community. But why did India become an imagined community? Why didn't Indians imagine other nations, Bengal, Bihar, Hindi Pradesh and what not? Why did they not? Why did they have choose India as a particular entity as a nation? Why did they imagine India as a nation? Of course, this is a question I won't go into just here on any other aspects. It has been argued that everything else in this world is an imagined community. Religious community, religion is an imagined community. There is no biological connection between one Muslim and another. There are all connections between mankind, but no connection in religious community. Caste, even caste is an imagined community to an extent, because not every one member of the caste is connected by recognizable marriage with another. Similarly, tribes. So almost every human formation apart from family is an imagined community. But I am coming back to the major point, which actually leads to the same, let's say, the problem of the, or theme of the factors behind the national movement. What were the reasons that India was imagined as a nation, apart from the geographical? Now, this raises the question of first British rule. India was conquered by a single power, Britain. And you know, it was soon recognized. I shall begin with elementary points first and come to the more substantive points later, but it is necessary to remember the elementary points first. In 1757, the Battle of Plassey occurred. The English occupied or subjugated the Nawab, the Nazim of Bengal. Siraj ud-Daulah was killed and he was replaced. Then in 1764, in the Battle of Buxar, Mir Qasim and his allies were defeated and the English became the tax collectors in Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, the Bihar, in 1765. And then occurred other wars, and by 1803, Mysore was finally decimated in 1799 at Seringapatnam. Then in the war of 1805, the Marathas were defeated. And so ultimately, by the time of the rebellion of 1857, India had been long subjugated. So first of all, India came under the subjection of a single foreign power. Now, English officers who had some serious thought about it, like Thomas Munro, Elphinstone and others, who knew Persian, who knew Indian languages, debated among themselves what made the British power different from the Mohammedan conquerors, the so-called Muslim conquerors or the earlier invaders. And they came to the conclusion that the British were, in one case singular, in that they did not allow any Indians to hold any kind of office, any kind of superior office in their administration. Every important officer of any authority had to be a Briton, either an Englishman or a Scotsman or an Irishman. Otherwise, no Indians would be appointed. Munro said in a note in 1820, when he was leaving India, one of his returns to England, a long note, that he wondered if the English regime in India could last because it was excluding all Indians all over the country. Not Bengalis, not Madrasis, not Marathas, but everyone was excluded. There were no allies. There were only enforced collaborators, no allies, no partners in British government. And he therefore wondered that a time would come when the Indians would rise and say, you have totally excluded us. So it's the nature of British government, colonial government, which must also be understood. Well, until 1900 and later, except for a very sprinkling of civil service officers, there were no Indian officers of importance. You know, when there was a debate, discussion was occurring, whether Muslims had their adequate place in the Indian civil service, I pointed out that in 1920, only 1 upon 20, that is out of 100, only 5 ICS men were Indians. How did it matter whether these 5 were Hindus or Muslims? 95 were Englishmen. So this total exclusion, often this is ignored in the textbooks, but the total exclusion of Indians from any important position, even as Dadabhai Nauroji pointed out, forget anything else, the old man of the founding father of the Indian National Movement, Dadabhai Nauroji, who began writing on India from 1867. He pointed out that in the college at Roorkee, which is now a university, but which only produced junior engineers in 1860s, only English products of Roorkee got jobs, no Indians. They couldn't get any jobs in the government. And there was hardly anything that a junior engineer could do. So either Eurasian or Europeans got the job as jobs came out. He figures, he gave the list, he gave the names. These people didn't get jobs from government. So it went down to even that stage. All engine drivers were English. All guards were English in the railways. So our founding father, Sir Sayyid Ahmad Khan, usually made a point of thanking the guard when he went down at the Aligarh station, that he had been so gracious to permit an Indian like him to travel on the train. This was not particularly to Sayyid Ahmad Khan, this was normal. You have to bow down to the English. Now, this was a major issue. There were, of course, other points of humiliation in railway engines. Most of the first and second class carriages were for Europeans only, no Indian could enter. So all these things count. Now, this meant that there was a direct contradiction between English and Indians as a whole. As I say, there was no particular caste or community of Indians who were favored. They were all excluded. And that, of course, created in the contradiction a unity among those who are excluded. But there were other major issues also. And they involved not only middle classes who sought office under the British and couldn't get it, but almost the entire people of India. First of all, there was what is called tribute to the British government. You see, England was a prosperous country in the 19th century. By the Industrial Revolution, it had become the leading industrial country in the world, at least until 1870s. A and yet it needed constantly a drain of wealth from India. That was called tribute by the English, and they also called it drain of wealth. These two words were not invented by Indians, they were used by the English people from the 18th century. They wanted large salaries for their government and for their officials to be transferred to Europe when they retired. So it was a very expensive government, very high taxation there. Part of this taxation also went into guaranteed profits for English firms like railways, who, although the ordinary rate of interest in England was about 3%, had a guaranteed profit of 5.5% at the cost of the Indian exchequer. So this also carried the drain. And there were then British properties in India, not owing to transfer of capital from England, but originating in India. Large lands were given to them free for plantations. They were given large concessions, tax concessions, to establish indigo plantations and so on. So there was a huge amount of what was called tribute. It amounted to something like, in the Nathuwa of the 19th century, something like 4 to 5% of the Indian national income, which is a very high amount for a poor country, because actually a poor country in the 19th century at the most saved 6 or 7% of the national income. So there was no capital formation in India because of the tribute. The tribute also affected peasants in particular, because the British government laid very heavy land tax. You know, you just can't imagine the land tax under British. The land tax, say, where you are sitting in Western UP, amounted to what was supposed to be 1666.6% or two-thirds of what was thought to be the zamindar's rent, the landlord's rent. Of this, two-thirds went to government. Now this calculation was on paper. It was not actually dependent on what was actually produced. Therefore, the burden of taxation was extremely heavy. And when the landlords were involved, then of course they also added their rent, and then the peasants suffered even more. In 1882, the UP, northwestern provinces, that was UP administration report, said that they could not imagine how Indian peasants lived under such taxation. You know, this is the British themselves saying. So it was a very heavy taxation regime. With such a low income, Indians paid more percent, higher percent of their per capita income in 1860s than the English people. So you can imagine the burden of taxation. When in the 1860s, the land tax, owing to the rebellion of 1857, the British got nervous. So they didn't increase the land tax, but they increased indirect taxes. Opium levy, salt levy, all these indirect taxes were increased. So India was a heavily taxed country. Now, as far as peasants were concerned, they realized that the land tax was heavy, and in 1857 this was one of the reasons for the peasants joining the rebellion. They did not so easily recognize the same burden when actually the government taxed through increasing the price of salt, cloth, and when they sold their opium, how little they received in return. These things didn't catch their eye. And it is here where Indian economic nationalism came in. What they didn't know, Dadabhai Nauroji now and others began to tell them about. Dadabhai Nauroji's book in 1901 is called Poverty and Un-British Rule in India, UNBRITISH. You see, in English language, British meant being brave, being just, being fair. The famous English phrase now much laughed at was to say to people, gentlemen, be men, ladies, be British. You know, this was, if you wanted to excite people and to feel that they were brave, you used to say. So British was something good. So Dadabhai Nauroji called British rule un-British rule, unjust rule, poverty and un-British rule. But this volume contained papers that he had been writing from 1867, that is 18 years before the formation of the Indian National Congress. And in this he pointed out how heavy the land tax was, and how peasants suffered, and how their poverty was therefore due to British rule. The same thing was done by Ramesh Chandra Dutt from 1880s. He was an Indian civil servant. He was one of the first Indians to pass the examination in England in the Indian Civil Service. He took voluntary retirement and he wrote on the British exploitation of India. So in 1901, his first book, major work, came out, Economic History Under Early British Rule, which brought the story to 1837. And then the other book came out in 1903, Economic History Under During the Age of Victoria, during the Victorian Age, 1837 to 1903. Now, in these two books, he exposed the way in which Britain was exploiting it. There was another, but that was for gain, but there was another way in which Britain was exploiting India, which these two people and other Indians, educated Indians, pointed on, and that was through what is called deindustrialization. By 1800, India had the largest cotton textile industry in the world, in Mughal times as well as up till 1800. Even the East India Company got its major profits from selling Indian textiles throughout the world. But then the Industrial Revolution had occurred in England, the textile industry was the major industry in England, and therefore these cotton textiles began to flood the Indian market. It flooded slowly. Indians, by hand loom, by spinning on charkha and then weaving the yarn on the hand loom, made the best clothing in the world, from muslin to printed cloth, and so on, called calico and chintz. Now, so it took time, but by 1870s, two-thirds of Indian cloth consumption was that of British cloth. So, weavers began to lose their employment. Women spinners, one of the age-old occupation of women was spinning. Previously through hand spindles, which was very bad for the fingers. And you know, I have always thought that men always leave the heavy work to women. And if you don't believe it, you study the history of spinning. Hand spindles are very difficult. From Indus civilization to 15th century when the charkha came, women spun yarn in China, in India, in Greece, in Rome, everywhere. And if you want to see how heavy work was taken by women, you look at any Mughal painting of building industry. All the bricks are carried by women. Men don't carry bricks. They are bricklayers. Even today, in many building sites, it's women who carry the bricks on their heads. So, but coming back to spinning was the major source of livelihood for women throughout India. And And when first yarn came, began to come from Britain, yarn also came from Britain. Then women began to do their dyeing. And when textiles, fully made cloth began to come, flooded the Indian market, then spinners and weavers both lost their life. So it is the British officials who throughout, they began to raise the alarm that what's going to happen to spinners and weavers. There's great, you know, Bentinck said that the plains of northern India are bleached with the bones of weavers. And of course, widows and others suffered enormously owing to the loss of spinning as livelihood. They had nothing. Now this was, unlike many other economic issues, this was an issue which everyone could see, particularly women and their menfolk, who now thought that the women had nothing to do, and when they are widows, what will they do, how will they be maintained, and similarly weavers and others, because there were a large number of professions involved in the textile industry. It was the largest industrial sector after agriculture. You had cotton carders, the so-called nabda. You had dyers, rangres. You had washermen, dhobis who actually washed the cloth, calicos before sale. You had all kinds of printers. Women used also to print cloth in large numbers. All these livelihoods went. So here the perception was general, you know, everyone felt it, that British rule had made that difference, and that you can see in the declarations in 1857, the mutineers' declarations, in which they particularly point out that Indians have lost their livelihood owing to British rule. So these were the economic factors that particularly united Indians. You know, when Dada Bhai Nauroji writes, he doesn't write about any religious community or any region. He was himself a Parsi. He wrote on, he knew Arabic and Persian by the way, and very wrote fine English. And he wrote about everyone. Whether there was a piece of injustice in the Punjab or whether there was a piece of injustice in Madras presidency, it didn't matter to him. Similarly, Ramesh Chandra Das. To him, the oppression was for all Indians. So the economic nationalism of their time by Justice Ranaday, G.V. Joshi, Subramaniam Iyer, many others, Devaskar, these are all figures before 1800, maybe 1900, and it was Justice Ranaday who caught, who used the term Indian economics for the first time, which was a course in my MA, BA in economics. I had to read it. All the troubles of India through British rule were put in our course called Indian economics. And I learnt later that the term went to Justice Ranaday of Maharashtra. Now, these are called economic nationalists. So economic nationalism was particularly new feature, which saw India as a nation economically exploited. So we have made two points. First is the political exclusion of Indians. Secondly, the economic exploitation of Indians. Then we come to the third point, which is very important, and one should not forget that. Ideas. You see, ideas don't have frontiers. They travel. I told you that Dada Bhai Nauroji had nothing to, that Raja Rohan Roy had nothing to do with France. He was, and there I'll, in his personality, there would be many things that are worth knowing. He belonged to a Persian and Arabic knowing bureaucratic family of Mughal administration. His title Rai came from Rai Rayan, and his title Raja was given by the Mughal Emperor Akbar Shah in Delhi, not by British. His early education had been in Persian and Arabic, and of course Sanskrit as a religious language. And his first book, Tahfatul Mubahideen, is in such difficult Persian that I have also to read it, although I did my own degrees in Persian also, but I have to read it in with a dictionary, stained glass, for understanding. Large quotations of Arabic verses from the Quran and others. I don't know how many know the meaning of Tuhfatul Mubahideen. Anyone? Yes. A gift for monotheists. He argued that all religions, what the name should be monotheist. And it will probably be come as a surprise that the first defender of Islam against Christian propaganda, missionary propaganda, was Ram Mohan Roy. Miratul Akhbar in Miratul Akhbar from 1850. But he soon became convinced that the day of these old ideas is over. Not monotheism, but theology is over. And modern science should be established. He opposed the idea of Hindu college at Banaras. And when Hindu college was established in Calcutta, one of the rules was that Ram Mohan Roy would be excluded from management. I don't know how many of you know that the name of our founding first institution, Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College, is also to Ram Mohan Roy, because his school was called Anglo-Oriental School. So our own name comes partly from Ram Mohan Roy. Anglo-Oriental education, English education in Indian languages. Now, he wanted scientific education. And of course, his opposition to Sati is well known. But what is important in Ram Mohan Roy is his espousal of the ideas of the French Revolution. This didn't come from England. In England, he was an utilitarian, which was at that time thought a rationalist, to be thought to be a rationalist school. I won't go into that. But he was a very great admirer of the great ideas thrown up by the French Revolution. One notion of the French Revolution, of course, was national unity, equality between men and women. That constitutes a united nation. And Ram Mohan Roy was the first person to say that India can't be a nation because it is divided up among castes. He wrote in a letter in 1828 that Indians are not patriotic because they believe in their caste. They don't see anything beyond the caste. Welfare of the caste is the only thing they want. Now you will be surprised why he doesn't say that Indians are divided into religious communities. Because actually in his time, the great religious divide had not come. Ram Mohan Roy itself advised other zamindars to have him, like him, marry a Muslim wife and have Muslim children by her. Because he said Hindu children don't look after their parents as Muslim children of a Hindu zamindar would. So this was quite normal in zamindar among the great zamindars of Bengal. And Barkat Ali, his son, actually lies alongside his grave in Bristol in England. So the religious divide had not yet come, but castes were there. Caste was extremely important. This particular notion of Raja Ram Mohan Roy brings us to the importance of the social reform movement for the rise of nationalism. You see, it soon became important, soon became noticeable, first of all in Bengal, that if you wanted India to be a nation, then it must do away with its past evils. particularly treatment of untouchables and caste system and the treatment of women. And the man who first brought this notion is unfortunately ill remembered in India, Keshav Chandra Sen. Keshav Chandra Sen, when he was only a clerk in a bank, from 1858 began writing about abolition of untouchability, the rejection of caste system, and the upliftment and equality of men, women with men, and also scientific education and women's education. In 1870, when visiting England, in his lectures he first raised the question, India can only be a nation if it treats all its people alike and if it treats its women fairly and if it has modern education. These were the three important pillars of Keshav Chandra Sen's. Now these became general. If India has to be a nation, it must get over its grave evils, mistreatment of women, mistreatment of outcasts and caste divisions, and lack of education, modern education. Now, education, by education they did not mean religious education. They meant modern, scientific, economic and political education. And English education, by the way, you should remember, was not established by English people in India, it was established by Indians. Delhi College was established by an Indian foundation. The great Lucknow noble of Delhi, who belonged to Delhi, established the Delhi College in 1820s. Agra College was similarly established. So apart from some missionary colleges, all the English colleges were established by Indians. They did not even receive any government grants. The total expenditure of British government on education, total expenditure, even in 1900 was 2% of their total income. Thanks. So you can understand the fact that English education was technically a gift of British rule, but it was actually funded by Indians, and the Indians brought it about. Now, once, it was often said, once you read English, you can't be restricted to Bible, you will have to, you can read John Stuart Mill, then he can be translated. Even so loyalist as Sayyid Ahmad Khan got John Stuart Mill's On Liberty translated into Urdu. So it will be translated into Urdu, Hindi and all the languages. And then the ideas will become general. Why can't Indians speak out? Why should there be censorship? Why should there be a press act? And so forth. All these issues came up. So the ideas, political ideas came with education. But it was not, as I would say, a gift of the British. It was actually through the effort of Indians, through a great educational reform movement, of which Aligarh is one example. But unfortunately, throughout the 19th century, a very small and petty example. There were much larger institutions in the country, like Presidency College and others, in which English education was now these ideas also included the idea that I'll come to in this particular section. I have further to say about Indian National Congress, but about the causes of the national movement, its nature and its objective. These ideas included the ideas of democracy, which did not come from England but essentially from the French Revolution. But from the Reform Act of 1832, the word democracy, even in English, had become respectable. That everybody should have a vote had become an idea which was respectable. And ultimately, in the Second Reform Act of 1866, it was put into effect. But not women, only men could vote. Women's vote came later in England. The second idea which was brought from England was that of constitution. You shouldn't have an arbitrary government, you should have a constitutional government, a parliament. So the ideas of parliamentary democracy, through perhaps a gradual constitutional development, if not with increasing number of voters and increasing power of local assemblies, these ideas began to spread among the middle classes, educated classes. So this also helped to establish nationalism, because I would return to my earlier definition of nation. The nation meant a single political unit. The nation meant a government of people from amongst the people of the country. So democracy was one form by which alone, to the national Indian nationalists, you could be governed. They rejected the princely states. Princely states were no form. Princes, Indian princes, and their administrations gave no alternatives. They also rejected, at least the major founders of the Congress. We shall come to this debate, we shall come to present. The religious influence. India was a multi-religious country. And somehow, in Bombay middle class, which was very important in the early national movement, Indian National Congress was established at Bombay, there was the industrial class there. It was a very mixed class. There were Parsis, there were Hindus, there were Muslims, all mixed up. If the owner is a Hindu, the manager would be a Muslim, the foreman would be a Parsi, that kind of mixture. So they didn't want any religious division. I also have mentioned Ram Mohan Roy. Perhaps you will be interested in one other statement of Ram Mohan Roy, which shows how religion to them was very unimportant. He was asked by a friend that my opposite litigant in the Calcutta High Court is an Englishman and he has an English advocate. If I have an English advocate, he would be able, but he won't argue against an English party. So whom should I employ, a Hindu lawyer or a Muslim lawyer? So Ram Mohan Roy said that a Hindu lawyer would be clever but dishonest. A Muslim lawyer would be honest but foolish. You know, the kind of free advice you have it. No care for anyone's religion. So this was the ideas, these were the people who built the early nationalist ideology both in Calcutta and Bombay. Now, there were problems in this, as we shall soon come to it. I will now, when we discuss the first years of the National Congress, as is given in the last portion of the synopsis. You see, Indian National Congress was established at its first session in 1885, December 1885, in Bombay. You write Bombay, but if you like, you can also write Mumbai. It is, historians write as the town was spelt at that time, its name in English, Bombay. And the man who established it was an Englishman, Alan Octavian Hume, or for brevity's sake, say A.O. Hume, H-U-M-E. Name is here, so in the synopsis. Now, Hume had been a civil servant. but had not risen very high because of his curious habits. He spoke Hindustani as an Indian. He knew both Urdu and Hindi. He was a great bird watcher. Among ornithologists, he is regarded as one of the two greats. A.O. Hume and Salim Ali are regarded as the two great bird watchers in India. He was in many ways half man. He was a believer in spiritualism, and even my transmigration of souls. So he had curious beliefs, but he was very greatly moved by his experience as an administrator, by the distress of the Indian people. That was one particular point on which there is no doubt that he made no concessions. Now, by 1870s, and there are various indications, it's not only Hume who is saying it, there had occurred some peasant disturbances, particularly the so-called Deccan peasant riots of 1872. And so there was a belief that things were coming which resembled the kind of feeling of unrest among the Indian people which had been seen before the rebellion of 1857. There was a supposition that the same kind of distress, weavers were unemployed, peasants were rioting, in the Deccan riots they had plundered moneylenders' houses. There were cases where they were not paying rent. And, you know, this Dada Bhai Nauroji also said in 1881 that Hindus, Muslims and Parsis are coming together and saying that we should overthrow this government. Everybody knows about it. Karl Marx also said that his informants had told him the same thing in around 1882. But Hume went further and he said that he had evidence from his religious friends that a conspiracy, deep-rooted conspiracy, was already working. And therefore, the British government, and I think he was using this to get some concessions out of Dufferin, Lord Dufferin, the Viceroy. So the British government should then allow Indians to form a constitutional association, whereby instead of secretly conspiring, they should put their demands before the British government. You see, I'm here, I don't agree that this was a conspiracy, and I will tell you why, because of another quotation from me. Indians were so afraid at that time that if the British government did not allow the Indian National Congress to hold a session, even if it frowned on it, they would not have attended it. Even in the first Congress session, Badruddin Tayyabji, who presided over the third session and is regarded as one of the earlier Congress leaders, didn't attend the first session on the specious ground that he had his holiday plans. You know, a national event like Indian National Congress, and he has holiday plans to go to Mathura on the holidays, is not near Bombay. He didn't attend. Now, so Indians were afraid. W.C. Banerjee, the first president of the Indian National Congress, talked only about social reform, not political reform. So it was very important for Hume to gather Indians whom he insisted on calling politicians, although they did not at that time regard themselves as politicians, to gather them and to form an association. In Bengal, things had gone ahead. There was an Indian association already, but that was restricted to Bengal. So the Indian National Congress first held its session in Bombay, and was, its only importance is, I think, that it was held. and that his name was important. Indian, National, and Congress, you see, the name of the American Parliament. American Parliament was called Congress. So there was a claim here that this was the beginning of an Indian Parliament, which of course meant that there would ultimately be a parliamentary democracy of which this would be the elected form. So the name was perhaps the most radical thing in the first Congress. But with the second Congress in Calcutta, with Dada Bhai Nauroji being president, things began changing. Now was the time to make strong speeches and make demands. Arms Act should be abolished, censorship should go, and so forth. And at the Madras Congress, where Badruddin Tayyabji was president, Surendranath Banerjee moved a resolution and got it passed against the Arms Act of the British government. And it was at that time that the British government woke up. Madras Congress was held in 1887, and the next Congress for the first time was to be held at Allahabad in northern India. Now, Dufferin then wrote a government resolution, which if you are those who are interested will find it in Phillips' book on documents on modern history of India and Pakistan. Dufferin wrote a whole note which he circulated, that the Indians, there is a minority of Indians, you know this word, microscopic minority for Indian National Congress began to be used. A very small minority, educated people, middle class people. What are they? They are now telling us, British administrators, who know the country in and out, than any doctor or lawyer could know, or sage could know, what is good for Indians. The problem of Indians, Dufferin said, were that they are overpopulated. India is an overpopulated country. It was the first time that this slogan came, overpopulated. And that the Congress doesn't include the actual part of responsible classes like landlords and others. And then began an immense campaign of all Indians. Our founder included. Sayyid Ahmad Khan made two very hostile speeches against the Congress in Lucknow and Bareilly. So hostile that even the English Times of India, that was represented British interests in Bombay, said he said the right things but in the most intemperate manner. Like saying that how can gentlemen tolerate darzis sitting with them on the same table? You know, nothing of Islamic equality there. I don't know why he picked up darzis as the Muslim. But Sayyid Ahmad Khan was one of the people who were now roused against the Congress. So Badruddin Tayyabji wrote to Hume that now that Lord Dufferin has declared war on the Congress, he replied to Sayyid Ahmad Khan, but this was a private communication to Hume which has now come out, that since the British government has declared war on the Congress, would it not be proper to postpone the Allahabad session? To which Hume replied, my dear Badruddin, we established the Congress not for the favor of Dufferin, Lord Dufferin, but for the Indian people. So he refused to postpone the Congress, and one third of the delegates in the Congress at Allahabad were Muslims. So it is not true that Muslims did not participate in the early building of the Congress. And it is also not true that Hume was a British agent who was trying to use the Congress as a safety valve, as a large number of radical nationalists later believed, just because we perhaps for nationalist reasons didn't want to pay sufficient credit to Hume for establishing our major organization of the national movement. Now, the